She's a new member to Hillview, although it feels like she's been here forever, doesn't it? In a good way.
Oh, no. No. It's gone like this.
It's gone like this for her. Okay, well, let's pray. Loving God, we pray that you will put Marlys at ease this morning, that she will look at all of us and it will feel like she's just talking to her family around the dinner table, telling her story. Lord, we pray that you will open our ears that we may be inspired by your word through her today. Amen.
Thank you. Okay, this isn't going to be as interesting as last week or the week before, but I hope I don't bore you. I'm going to call this my looking back. I was born in the beautiful state of Wisconsin. My parents were very religious and took the Bible very literally. My youth years were spent in the heart of Wisconsin on a small dairy farm, and I vowed I'd never, ever marry a farmer. My parents came through the Great Depression with five children, three boys and two girls. I was the middle child. We always went to Sunday school and church, and it was embedded in us to go to Sunday school and church every Sunday, regardless of the weather. It could be the worst storm ever, but my mother said, "We're going." My dad said, "I'm not getting the horses out to pull the car." But my mother said, "I'll shovel in." And we always went. He didn't always go with us, but somehow we got there. We were taught to not smoke, drink, swear, dance, play cards, lie, cheat, steal, or associate with Catholics or Lutherans. And those that did were not considered Christians. This is how they defined Christian back in those days. That was kind of a definition of Christianity. Some siblings still feel this way, though, which is rather sad. Silently, I questioned it, but I felt guilt and shame for questioning it. I was not embraced for trying to show my own individuality. As time went by and looking back, I can see this was really narrow-minded thinking. Most of my young days I remember as happy ones. In 1937, after my baby brother was born, things changed. Us kids were aware that mother did not want this baby because they were so financially burdened. So she made it my responsibility to feed and diaper the baby. I stuck him so many times, it's a wonder he survived. I thought he was my doll. As time goes by, I look back and feel what a blessing it was to care for my baby brother. Mother's temperament changed quite drastically. After time went by, I was able to look back and realize she had a mental condition problem. Our family became a very dysfunctional one. In my adolescent years, I did not have a good relationship with my mother, as I always questioned her on almost everything, and maybe I'd say everything. In 1969, before her death, we did show our love and appreciation to each other and had some good laughs about the past. Dad remained patient, understanding, very reserved, and the solid rock of our family. After high school in the summer of 1949, I worked in the hospital as nurse's aide in a small town close to home. I had decided I wanted to be a nurse. One hot and very humid afternoon, my girlfriend and I went for a short walk, and suddenly one of those famous Wisconsin thunderstorms came up. And there was, on the street with rain, thunder, and lightning, I met the love of my life. I didn't know it at the time, but it was Bill. He was with the Air National Guard from St. Joseph, Missouri. Many National Guardmen spend encampment at Volk Field, Wisconsin. They came from Iowa, Minnesota, Illinois, Michigan, Kansas, and Missouri. So there were a lot of young men out there on the street. Late summer of 1949, our minister at that time talked to my parents about enrolling me in a two-year religious college in Evanston, Illinois. It was funded in part by the Methodist Church, and I would earn an associate degree. Mother thought I should go and be a missionary. I wanted to be a nurse. They sent me there. Well, I signed up for nursing and worked to pay my expenses. My parents did not have to pay anything. Mother was so upset that I took nursing courses that she demanded I quit and return home and work on the farm. I called my parents and talked with Dad and asked if he agreed. He advised me that I should do what my heart tells me. So I did, but I was filled with feelings of guilt and shame. So I stayed and finished 1 year and was working on transferring to Northwestern University, as they would accept all the credits I could continue with nursing and graduate with an RN BS degree. My thought was mother would help to some degree with finances, at least for education, but I was wrong. I was so disappointed and so discouraged. So the other path I chose to take was to stay in Evanston and go to work. I found a place to live and a job. I joined the Swedish Methodist Church, and every Sunday evening the youth group would take food and go to Skid Row to a mission house in Chicago where the homeless and addicted people lived. We would have a worship service and serve refreshments and mingle with those who wanted to talk or play games and sing hymns. There I learned that they were not bad people, but somehow lost their way somewhere. Looking back, they taught me a very important lesson. Love your neighbor as yourself, and do not judge others. That is narrow-minded thinking. There was someone guiding me that took me down the road to be a secretary, which I really enjoyed. I worked for two different companies before my last job. Looking back, it was the faith I had that I was not aware of that kept me going. In the spring of 1951, Bill asked me to marry him. I loved him more than my desire to be a nurse, so I said yes. So in July, Bill and I were married, now 67 years, in my parents' church. Mother was very, very opposed to it. It has been quite a journey, too, but with love and faith, all things are possible, and Bill and I had both. Bill is the one with patience. Looking back, God was always there. But I still carried that guilt and shame. In 1952, Bill was discharged from the Air Force, and we made our home in St. Joseph, Missouri, where his family lived, and we were very active in a small Presbyterian church. Bill held a couple of other jobs before he settled working, or as he always put it, slaving, for 25 years for a medical supply company. And I retired after 30 years being secretary to the president and owner and to the chairman of the board at a wire rope manufacturing plant. In the early 1980s, I nearly lost my job at this wire rope plant because I agreed to be a witness in a discrimination lawsuit. We only had one black office worker out of approximately 140 office employees and 1,500 plant employees. It was so obvious what the office managers were doing with Joyce that I could not sit quietly and watch her being emotionally and mentally abused. The wire rope company settled the suit just when court was to begin, and they settled in Joyce's favor. Looking back, I can see where I had faith and did not know it, because I was so scared I'd lose my job, but I kept going with my determination to be a witness for her. Mr. Barclay, the president, lost his 13-year-old son in the late 1980s in an auto and bicycle accident. He asked that Bill and I stay at their house. Bill could go to his job from there, and I could take care of all of the friends and business calls and make arrangements for all out-of-city and state family for airline reservations and whatever needed. I had to see that everyone had food, drink, and all that goes with it. Looking back, my faith helped me through this very sad and stressful time. And also in the late 1980s, my assistant and I were summoned to appear before a federal grand jury in New Orleans on charges that our wire rope company, along with several small companies, were accused of price fixing. The companies quietly settled. It was very stressful. But looking back, this was another time my faith took over. Bill and I were so blessed with a beautiful and lovable daughter in 1954. Because of our daughter, Cynthia, we are here in Boise and visited Hillview United Methodist Church. We also visited other churches, but once we visited here, we stayed. We became members and have met so many caring and wonderful members and friends, like Artrice and Chuck. They took us under their wings. We are so thankful for friends like them. Looking back, we are so blessed we took that journey from St. Joseph, Missouri to Boise, Idaho to join our daughter and family. As Matthew 22, verse 37 says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest commandment. Through the years, I had faith, and at times, great faith. And other times, I really doubted my faith, and I still do at times. What does it mean? What does it mean to have faith? How do you know if you receive it? These examples are just a few where faith was always there for me and I didn't know it. Looking back, I can see that I always had it and didn't always know it. I feel I have grown stronger in my faith since attending Hillview and the various Bible studies, especially the sermons by Pastor Brenda and Reverend Pete Nelson's studies. I can look forward and no longer feel shame and guilt. I really feel liberated. Amen.
Did you realize they have an opportunity to ask you a few questions?
Oh.
Yeah, go ahead and stay back up. And look, we've already got a question here.
Okay.
I'm very glad that your parents take the Bible literally, though. I'm to have the same beliefs as your parents on, and my goal is to have eternal life as Jesus Christ, but I live in a group home independent demon services. I tend to get nerves around supervisors. They have authority over me, and we lost two helpers, one unexpectedly. Now the supervisor has to cover a lot, and I was selfish and greedy and did not want her spending night then. And so I'm sorry for praying for bad weather, like from thunderstorms to blizzards when I go to Alfonso spring break. But there are consequences for wrongdoing. It will teach me not to worry about when we get new helpers at group homes, and because the supervisor's in control of it, and I have a problem of worrying.
Yeah, well, through it all, going to church as a youngster, it apparently gave me a lot of faith. It was there. I didn't always know it.
Well, I know Brenda's always got a question. Let's see what her question is today. Do you have any today? Lisa, I mean,
I already asked my questions this week.
Oh, okay.
Because I asked if your mother ever did come to love Bill. And also, you know, to tell us a little bit about Bill's background. I mean, you were raised thinking that all of these things were wrong and what it meant to be a Christian. So my understanding is that Bill sort of exemplified some of the stuff that you were taught was wrong.
Oh, yes. And it seemed like any boyfriend I took home was the wrong kind. But yes, she really opposed it. It caused a lot of dysfunction in the family. But I was determined I was going to get married in our church. And Mother, as the years went by, she could see that even though Bill maybe smoked and drank a beer or two, and he loved to dance, but he also loved people and did things for others and was caring, and he was able to look through some of the bad qualities that her mental illness gave her. And yes, she came to love Bill. In fact, she died of cancer, and Bill was the only one that she would eat for. There was all of my siblings there and my dad, and she wouldn't eat for any of us, but she ate for Bill. And I thought that was her way of saying, I love you.
Judy's got a question over here.
Marlys, I was so impressed with your courage and integrity to support your friend Joyce on the discrimination. Could you just tell us a little bit more and a little background of that? Because I don't think we appreciate how much courage it took for you to do that.
Okay, well, it was a company that was, of course, all white. And it was when the government wanted to have some black people intermingle in with the companies that they were basically forced to hire someone. So they hired Joyce thinking she was illiterate and they would be able to get rid of her pretty quick. And all the conversations I would hear in the lunchroom would be about, you know, how bad it was to have a black person and how degrading it was to the company. And so when Joyce came in, I was friendly with her. They didn't like that. But the president of the company that I worked for, he was open-minded, realized they had to do it. But he didn't say anything that I shouldn't do it. But all of the lower management were the ones that really carried on about her. And they'd pass her around from manager to manager, and they'd say, she can't do the job, let's fire her. She can't get the job done. They'd sit in the lunchroom, she can't get the job done, let's fire her. And she was doing a better job than other girls that were working around her. And the other girls knew that, but they didn't want to work with a black girl. So they would tell lies to the managers. So Joyce had a really tough time. She stuck it out. She had a lot of faith. She prayed to God. She'd pray to these people. She'd go to these people and pray to them, pray with them, saying, you can see that none of us were all the same. But they didn't go along with that. They wanted to get rid of her. So finally she had the courage to go and file a discrimination suit and asked if I would be a witness, and I said yes, and my assistant said she would be a witness, and there was two other girls that said they would be witnesses. And so when time came for court, all four of us went down to Kansas City court, the courthouse, and was waiting for the trial to begin when our little wire rope company settled, and Joyce was happy with the settlement. She just couldn't tell what the settlement was. That was a promise she had to make, but she was happy with it.
Let me see. What happened when you returned to the company with the vice president?
When I returned to the company, why, there was a vice president that asked me to clear off my desk. And I said, well, okay, but I need to make a phone call first. And I picked up the phone because the attorney had told, that was representing the four of us, said that if you're given a problem when you go back, you call me because they will have a discrimination lawsuit on their hand. So when I picked up the phone, he knew what I was going to do. He took the phone out of my hand and walked away. So, but the president that I worked for, then he thanked me for being brave. But he didn't have the courage to really stand up. Joyce continued with the company and retired from the company. And everybody was different toward her after that suit because the company settled in her favor.
Well, you know, you said different. Did they actually accept her in the end, though, over time?
I would say 50% did.
Yeah, that's better than four.
Right.
In the beginning.
It does. St. Joseph was pretty divided. They had a lot of black people that lived there, but they had their section that they lived in, their schools. And so when all of this integration took place, why, they had to follow suit.
And did there were many more black people soon after she won the lawsuit, or soon after they settled?
No, they never hired another black person in the office. They did in the plant, but not in the office.
Mm-hmm. Were you connected with the Methodist Church before you came here, or when did you go from Presbyterian to Methodist?
Okay, I grew up in a church, Methodist Baptist Church, if you believe that. And they called it the Federation Church. And the little town that was near our dairy farm was a population of 478. And they had five taverns and six churches. And the Methodists and Baptists were dying. And they decided to combine. And the Methodist Church was going downhill and keeping up the building. And the Baptists had a good church, but they didn't have a congregation. So they offered the Methodists the Baptist Church. And then in the beginning, they traded off preachers, Methodists and then Baptists 1 year and Methodists. And then finally, they just decided to go the Methodists. So I basically grew up in a Methodist church and went to Presbyterian after Bill and I were married. We went to a Methodist church for a little while, but this little Presbyterian church had a wonderful, warm, similar to Hillview for a long, long time. And then, as most churches do, they grew and divided. But we stayed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Corey, it was very warm, just like Hillview. You know,
yeah.
Friendly, open.
Hillview is, from all other churches we've ever been to, Hillview has been the warmest I've ever been in. I just love it. And it feels like, with God, He's led us here.